today we'll be looking at this biomethanation reaction. Now, what happens in biomethanation is something like this. Generally, you have insoluble organics. Say, if you're going to a dairy industry, for example, the waste organics, a lot of solids are coming. So, insoluble organics, it gets digested by extracellular enzymes in the reaction equipment and becomes soluble organics. And then, volatile acids forming bacteria works on it to give you acetic acid, and then gasification by methane producing bacteria to give you methane and carbon dioxide. So, it is a three-step reaction, that is what you see in the biomethanation process. Stage 1 is solubilization, stage 2 is acid formation, stage 3 is gasification using methane bacteria. Now, generally we find that it is not a bad assumption to assume that the methane producing step is the slowest step of the reaction. So, the most of the designs therefore is done on the basis of this assumption that methane producing is the slowest step. Okay. Although there are instances where this solubilization is quite slow, as a result we may have to take this also into account. So, as far as this problem is concerned, we are looking at production of methane using acetic acid as a substrate, and that is the chemical reaction that is set up, acetic acid. So, this is the chemical representation of what is going on. Acetic acid, this is the nitrogen that is present in the environment to give you some bacterial growth, which is, this is the chemical representation of bacteria, and methane and carbon dioxide. Okay. So, you notice here that roughly equal quantities of methane and carbon dioxide is produced volume basis. There is a lot of literature in biomethanation over the last 30, 40 years. Many, many plants have been set up all over the world. It is a reasonably well known technology. There are many problems with it. We will talk about it as we go along. Okay. Now, what seems to be an appropriate growth function is, let me write down the growth function. The growth function is something that we have set up. It looks something like this, mu m, mu equal to mu m within brackets 1 by 1 plus K s by H s and H s by K I. This was proposed by Graif and Andrews way back in 1974. There is a lot of material on this. Okay. What is H s? H s is the unionized acid. Okay. So, this is the unionized part of acetic acid, which is what is important as far as the growth function is concerned. Okay. The numbers are given, K s is given, K I is given. This form of rate function we have seen earlier also. This is a form where substrate inhibits the rate of chemical reaction, and therefore, we would like to operate the process at H s value equal to K s times K I square root. So, the best choice of H s, which is the substrate which is active as far as the process is concerned, is square root of H s times K I. You can calculate that from here. Okay. So, what you want to look at is very important area, dairy wastewater. I have just taken 3000 cubic meters per day, 6000 milligrams per liter, 6000 roughly 100 millimoles, not mole, 100 millimoles, sorry, 100 millimole per liter is the concentration of acetic acid that will come out of this 3000 milligrams per liter, sorry, 6000 milligrams per liter. Okay. It is being treated in a chemostat. Chemostat is our CSTR equivalent, of which we have talked about already. Okay. What we want to do is just get an idea of the size and what are the outputs that we can expect. Okay. Now, when you go around the world, you find that dairy wastewaters, what they would do is that they would first do a biomethanation. And as you will see, as you go around this problem, we will see that biomethanation is not able to completely remove or consume this 6000 milligrams per liter. It is only able to do part of it. In other words, the effluents that come out of dairy wastewater still is very concentrated from the point of view of discharge. So, you will have to do another step of treatment before it is suitable for discharge. So, we will have to look at that also to find out how to handle these kinds of problems. Okay. So, if this is the rate function, where mu is mu m times this one. So, what is the best choice of H s that we will take? What is that value? Tell me. What is that? Please calculate and tell me. This is the ionization reaction here. K a is given. K a is given somewhere, I think. K a is 4.5 and operating pH is 6.8. So, you can find out what is the H s value. Okay. So, the H s at which we will operate is 0.15. Okay. Is that okay with everybody? 0.15. Root of K 1, K 2, K s, K I square root is 0.15. Is it all right? Do we all agree? This is what I have got. H s optimum, I have got 0.15. Okay. So, as per the data given, the best choice mu equal to D, correct? We must have mu equal to D, chemostat mu equal to D. Therefore, the dilution rate at which we will operate is 0.27 per day. Is it okay? Can you please calculate and tell me whether there is mistake in my calculation? 0.27 per day is okay? 0.27 is all right? Okay. So, what should we have? So, our equipment volume should be 3000 divided by 0.27. That is about 11,000 cubic meters is what you get. 3000 divided by 0.27 is about 11,000. Is it all right? 11,000 is okay. So, what is the now if it is 11,000, what is the value of S minus? I will get is a 1795. S minus comes from the acetic acid equilibria here. What is the equilibria is given? All the numbers are given. Yes or no? So, what is the acetic acid that you have started with still remains unreacted? There is acetic acid that still remains unreacted. 1795 is S minus. How much is H s? Can you calculate what is H s at the end of the process? S minus. What is the H s? Is this correct? If there is a mistake, tell me, I will correct it. 0.15 millimole per liter. 0.15 multiplied by 60 is 9, isn't it? Is it all right? See, we are operating the process as optimum value of HS. HS optimum is 0.15 millimole per liter. That is what you told me. Multiplied by 60 is the molecular weight of acetic acid. So, I put it as 9. Is it okay? So, what are we saying? That we are the process, we are feeding at 6000 and the biomethanation reduces it to 2000. Is that clear? So, biomethanation process is able to reduce the organics to a level of 2000. It is not able to reduce it to a level that is suitable for discharge. So, it is 18 answer. So, I have to make some adjustment in these numbers. So, these numbers are not exactly correct. Okay, please help me now. So, what is the loss of COD? S naught minus of S. So, this is it is not exactly 6. So, you tell me the actual numbers, please. So, it is 6 minus 1.8, okay, not 2. So, this is not exactly 12,000, it will be slightly less, slightly more. So, please tell me these numbers. 12,600. Is it okay? Is it all right? Okay to everybody? So, what are we saying? That so much of loss of COD has happened, 12,600. Now, if you look back at our stoichiometry, it says, what does it say? CO2 and they are roughly in equal volumes. So, in terms of mass basis, I have calculated here. So, based on this, just look back at this one. For every 60, we get 0.92 times methane, which is 0.92 times 16 and 0.92 times 44, correct? So, that is YXS, this is YPS and this is YP carbon dioxide. So, that is what I have done. So, fraction methane to substrate is 0.24, I get carbon dioxide to substrate is 0.67. Please verify if it is okay. 16, how did I get? 1795, so brilliant question. See, 29.9 multiplied by 60, is it okay? All right. Is it okay with everybody? Okay, okay. Now, please tell me if these numbers are correct. 0.92 times 16 is 0.24 and then 0.9244 is 0.67. Okay. So, if I ask you what is the methane fraction in biogas, what will you tell me typically weight by weight? methane fraction 0.24 divided by 0.91, whatever that number is. So, you will find in biogas on weight basis the methane is not more than about 26-27%. Okay. On volume basis it is equal, on weight basis it is only 25-26%. Is it okay with everybody? 0.24, 0.67. All right? Okay. So, what is the methane production? I've made a small mistake here, so you can tell me. So, it is 600. So, this number is how much? Please tell me. 3025. Okay, fine. 0.26, is it? Just a minute. There are some important questions are coming. Please understand. What is the mistake we have made here? Please tell me. COD loss is 12,600. Okay, that is, this is the acetic acid loss. Out of that, we said this is the fraction. Okay, that is why you multiplied by 0.24. What we are saying is, for every 60, we are getting 0.92 times 16. So, that is the fraction we are talking about. Is it okay? Is it okay with everybody what we are saying? All right. So, where are we? So, we have 3000 kg of methane and so many kilograms of, some slight mistake is here. What is this number? Please tell me. 12,684,40. Okay, fine. Suppose I ask you what is the thermal value of biogas, what will you tell me? What is the thermal value of biogas? So, the methane, I have calculated here, just to put it in the context. Methane is about 14,000 kilocalories per kilogram. I have taken this from the literature. So, biogas is about close to 5,000 kilocal, 3,600 per kg or per cubic meter, you can also calculate that, I have done that. So, 3,640 is what we get, showing that biogas is a lean gas. It is not a very rich gas, it is a lean gas. Okay. And therefore, its combustion in a IC engine will require suitable design, which people have done already. It is very popular around the world. Biogas engines are operating very well. Okay. And what is the problem that we face with biogas in IC engines? The problem with IC engines is that in this reaction, if there is protein, generally you produce hydrogen sulfide here, and that creates problems in the combustion, for which in small scales it is not easy to handle, in large scales you can remove the hydrogen sulfide. Okay. What we find is that biomethanation gives you biogas, yes, it gives you very good thermal value, but it produces a wastewater which is not ready for discharge. Okay. So, we must look at doing a system design in which the wastewater is taken care. And this wastewater, we said the effluent that is comes out of biogas is this is 18.04, somebody said. Okay. So, we said yesterday that our systems will have a dilution rate of this type, correct, where mu m I have taken whatever you have done yesterday. So, this is the kind of number I get. Okay. So, the second system which will take care of the wastewater is that it has a dilution rate of 0.5 and the system volume of 6000. Is this okay? Please tell me. This is all right. 3000 cubic meters per day is coming. The dilution rate is 1 by B times mu m s k s and all that I have taken of yesterday's values, or I have given you yesterday. So, D value is 0.3, this becomes 0.5, and this is what I get. Please tell me if it is okay. Is it okay? I have taken B as 0.3, mu m as 0.3 per day, k s as 10. This is in problem number 1. Same thing we have done this yesterday. Same number. Say B is 0.3, everything is what we have done yesterday. Okay? Yes or no? Shall we go forward? All right. Where are we? Okay. So, we have an equipment size of 6000 cubic meters, which is for treatment of that wastewater. Okay? And what is the size of the equipment for the biomethanation? What was biomethanation size we got? 11,000. So, you can say 11,000 plus 6000, 17,000 cubic meters have been used up. Now, let us look at the real problem. The real problem is here. See, what happens is that, is this correct? Total COD loss that in this, in bio, this is in biogas. Is this correct what I have written? It's 2000. See, we have to remove, see, we have to see what comes out of the biogas plant is at 2000 milligrams per liter, 3000 cubic meters. So, the total amount of COD that we have to treat in the effluent treatment plant, or the ETP they call, is this. Is this correct? Let me repeat. What comes out of the biogas plant is 1.804, okay. So, this is slightly less. So, it is 540 kg per day, okay. So, what comes out to the biogas plant comes at 1804, I have written 1.8 kg per cubic meter, 3000 cubic meters, so 5400 kg per day has to be handled in your ETP plant, correct? Is this okay? What we are saying? I am coming to that, okay. Now, how much oxygen is required to treat to oxidize 5400 kg of oxygen demand? If it is typically glucose, 1:1 is a reasonable number. So, to be able to process 5400 kg, so you will require 5400 kg of oxygen. Now, you can ask how this number comes from. Of course, this number comes from practice. If you go to any waste treatment plant, they will tell you that for every kilogram of oxygen demand, you roughly require 1 kilowatt hour of energy. That means, your aeration equipment, the amount of energy that you must put in so that, you know, it sort of bubbles through this, is about 1 kilowatt hour for every kilogram of oxygen you have to supply. Is this clear? So, if you have 5400 kilograms of oxygen to be supplied, you will require 5400 kilowatt hour of electricity. So, how many kilograms of methane did we produce? 3024, okay. So, to produce, see what we do in a, this one is that we burn a methane and then convert it to electricity. So, you have 3024 kg methane burning, and then generally efficiency is between 0.3 to 0.2 in that range, okay. In other words, 20 to 30%, typically 22-23% of the thermal energy is converted to electricity, okay. So, I have just estimated, these numbers are not correct, please tell me now. 3024, 14,000 by 860, what is the number correct? If it is 0.3, what is it? If it is 0.2, what is it? 770. If it is 0.2? Okay. So, what we are saying is that if you burn this, you can get so much of electricity. If it is at 30% efficiency, so much. If it is 20% efficiency, so much. Generally, you will find that IC engines efficiencies are quite good. So, you might get something in this range, okay. Say it again, by 860. See, kilocalories to kilowatt hour conversion, see 860 kilocalories equal to 1 kilowatt hour. This is something that I have learnt in my school. Okay. So, what we are trying to say here is that, see, in ETP, you consume so much and you generate so much. Okay. So, there is a slight power surplus, okay, this power surplus which is used for various other purposes. Is this clear? So, when you have biogas plant, you have some surplus energy which can be used for various other purposes. Part of the reason why biogas is a very popular in various places is that it does give you some power surplus. Very good question. Let us just go back to that question. Where are we? We calculated COD loss for the biogas plant, which is converted to biogas. We calculated COD loss in the ETP plant, which is converted to carbon dioxide. Okay. In both cases, there is a loss of carbon. In one case, the carbon is given, comes to you as methane. In another case, the carbon comes to you as carbon dioxide. Is that clear? Now, the important point to recognize here is that in many places you will find when they do this power production using gas, the wasted energy, which is the exhaust from the engine, in many of these dairies, they need lot of hot water, because dairy requires lot of washing to be done in various places. Therefore, they are able to use that energy to generate hot water. And because of that, the thermal efficiency of the process, because they are able to recover a lot of heat from the waste heat, thermal efficiencies are very high. In other words, many of these dairies, if they are able to integrate biogas, wastewater treatment, and therefore that wastewater, they are able to convert it into hot water and use it for various kinds of washing. So, it integrates very nicely in terms of thermal, in terms of say protecting the environment and so on. So, it is very popular around the world if you can afford the investment on the biogas plant, investment on the waste treatment. Both are very large energy intensive, investment intensive activity. Okay. The second exercise, see, alcohol fermentations are status in this country, of course, all the alcohol in this country is produced from sugarcane molasses. Okay. And in many parts of the world, particularly the warmer regions of the world, it is from sugarcane molasses. Okay. Now, this data that I have taken is the rate at which the substrate gets consumed is given by this function mu m s k minus k p and all that. These numbers by and large hold for sugarcane molasses, okay. And these numbers 0.17, all these effects are quite okay. Now, what happens in a sugar industry is that the molasses comes to you as a 50% sugar. 44, 45, sometimes 48%. 48% means 400 to 500 grams per liter as hexose sugar. Now, industry, what they will do is that they will dilute this to about 10%. Okay. They will dilute this from 500 or 450 grams per liter to 100 grams per liter. The question is, fermentation alcohol industries typically dilute molasses to 100 grams per liter. Why? Okay. Now, you will realize that, let me write this stoichiometry here, C6H12O6 giving you twice C2H5OH plus twice CO2. This is 180, this is 92, this is 88. Okay. In other words, strictly anaerobic conversion of hexose sugar to alcohol is actually roughly 49-51%, okay. Roughly say 50-50, is that clear? Now, if you start with 1 gram of sugar, you will get half a gram of alcohol, okay. Now, if it is, if you start this as 100 grams per liter, okay, then you should get 50 grams per liter of alcohol, correct? Is that clear? If you had started with 500 grams per liter, you would have got 250 grams per liter of alcohol. Okay. Therefore, the amount of water you have to remove, in this case, it is only 4 times, you know, 250 to, you know, you have to only remove for every kg of alcohol, you have to remove 750 kg of water. Here, you will have to remove 950 kg of water. Just see the difference. If you could have used 500 grams per liter sugar, you are removing 750 kg of water for every kg of alcohol. Here you are using for every 50, you are removing 950. So, 1 to 19, here it is 1 to 3. You can see the advantage if you can use a higher concentration. Is that clear? Alcohol industries, they do not use 500 grams per liter, they use 100 grams per liter. They are willing to sacrifice this advantage. Why? Because the energy cost of distillations are very high, we all know that. But in spite of the fact that the energy cost is so high, they dilute it to 100 grams per liter and not work with 500 grams per liter. So, question is why? Is the question clear to all of you? Why do we dilute molasses? I am saying it again. Molasses is available in a sugar industry, typically 500 grams per liter as hexose sugar. Now, this is diluted to 100 grams per liter hexose sugar prior to fermentation. Question is why? What I am trying to explain here is that if they could have worked with 500 grams per liter, they would have got 250 grams per liter of alcohol. Therefore, for every 250 grams, they have to evaporate 750 grams of water, 1 to 3. For every kg, 3 kg of water has to be evaporated. But if they do this, they have to remove 50 to 950, so 1 to 19. the amount of water to be removed in this case is for every kg, 19 kg of water has to be removed. While here it is only 3 kg. So, there is such a great advantage in distillation when you can use 500, but they only use 100. The question is why? The answer is, there are many answers, many reasons why they do this. First reason is that molasses is extremely viscous. It is so viscous that it is not easy to pump at all. If you want to pump molasses, you will have to dilute. Okay, that is the first reason. Secondly, molasses contains lots of suspended solids which comes from the process. See, what we do is that we have crystallized the sugar, so we are just rejecting what we are not able to recover, correct? So, it has lot of suspended solids, and to be able to remove the suspended solids, you have to reduce the viscosity. So, that is another reason why they dilute. The third reason they dilute is this, that this negative effect of alcohol accumulation in the process which inhibits the rate of chemical reaction. It is called product inhibition. All these factors combined make it essential for them to dilute it to a level which they can work with. Is that clear? That is why they dilute. Third is this reason, that alcohol accumulation in the process inhibits the rate of chemical reaction. Because of this minus Kp, you can look at this, this reason. Okay. This minus Kp effect, so that makes it worse. So, that is why they would dilute. Thank you, my friend. Okay, let us go forward now. Now, let us quickly calculate. Let us say we have the typical size of alcohol distilleries in Brazil is very big, but ours is only 40 tons per day is typical, and the biggest would be a little larger. So, if you are looking at a 40 tons per day alcohol factory, so I have just made some calculation, a 40 tons per day alcohol factory. How much should be this F, 40 tons per day? Is this correct? Just see whether what this calculation is correct. 40,000 kg per day, I have divided by 24, okay. And then this is the S naught is 100, S is 10. So, we are taking it out to 90% conversion. So, I put it 90, okay. And you can see here YP is 0.4, okay. Only 40% of alcohol is we get, okay. 48% is carbon dioxide, you see. Is it all right? And the remaining 40, and then this is 48. What happens to the remaining? This is 8. It is going elsewhere. So, only 8% is cell, so 96, still 4% is unaccounted. There are other products that are formed in fermentation, you know, little bit of glycerol and other products are formed. That is why the data is not there. Okay. So, what is F equal to? 46 is this correct? 46. 46 cubic meters per hour. So, what is the concentration of alcohol in solution? What is the concentration of alcohol in solution? ?36 kg per cubic meter, okay. It is 3.6%, okay. 3.6% is the alcohol in solution. So, in other words, if you start with 1 kg, you get 36% is alcohol, okay. The rest is going to carbon dioxide. See, you can see here 8% is cell, 48% is carbon dioxide, and there are some side reactions like glycerol and all that which takes away a little bit. So, what the useful alcohol is only 40%, okay, not much more than that. And please recognize 90% conversion of hexose sugar is also not very common, you know. The reason is this inhibition makes it quite difficult to handle. As alcohol accumulates, this inhibition becomes worse. So, you will find a process, a very good factory in India would be 82-83%, not much more than that, okay. So, we are looking at is here we are getting 36 kg per cubic meter, okay. But in actuality, we are not looking at much more than about 30, 29, 30, like that, okay. That is what is the common. So, the amount of energy that is required to recover this alcohol is very large, okay. So, for 36 means you have to remove 9 960 kg of water has to be removed to be able to concentrate this. Okay. So, this is a serious problem. The problem with alcohol fermentation lies really in the chemical reaction equipment. We have not been able to figure out what is the way to take it forward. Okay. Now, an interesting work got done in Berkeley in 1970, very old research. They spent a lot of time in trying to see whether this problem that we are facing here of very lean concentration of alcohol and very high energy cost of recovery, can we do something about it? 1970s, 1980s, it still goes on, and then various kinds of answers have been given. Let me quickly run through that, because the context is important, but before that let us just finish off this. What is the dilution rate at which we must operate the plant? What is the dilution rate? Mu m is 0.5, s is 10, is it right? S is 10, yes or no? S is 10 and k is minus 0.017, p is 30, I think it is okay. 0.22 is correct, 525 roughly seems all right. Okay. So, what is the size of the equipment? Suppose you are producing 40 tons per day of alcohol, what is the size of the equipment that you will have? Size of the equipment is what I have got here, about 200 cubic meters per hour. Now, this is the term. See, what is the productivity for alcohol? D times P is about 8 kg per cubic meter per hour, or 8 grams per liter per hour. Is it clear what we are saying? And this is what makes the whole technology a little unviable, because per unit volume of equipment you are not producing very much. Okay. In 7.9 kg per cubic meter per hour. Now, if you look at the reality of alcohol production in India, what you find is the situation is much worse, because this is for a continuous process where there is no shutdown time, you know, filling and emptying, which is a very substantial amount of time is required to fill and remove, and then in between also you have to clean the equipment and so on. You will find, because of the fact that the see here our residence time is about 5 hours, correct, but you will find there the actual filling time and then cleaning time etcetera, it becomes 18 hours. Okay. So, this what we are getting as 7.9 actually more like 2 or 3 grams per liter per hour is what we achieve in a commercial process. Is this point clear to all of you? And all the problem arises from the fact that we haven't got that chemical reaction technology right. The real that engineering of that reaction is where the problem is. That is why all these problems are coming. Okay. Therefore, just look at what was done. So, people have looked at what can we do. I mean, from the point of view of reactor design, is there anything we can do? Is that clear? Is the problem clear to all of you? So, you have just done a calculation for a continuous process. We said that its productivity is 7.9, correct, based on the fact that we have produced 36 kg per cubic meter and our dilution rate is 0.22, and therefore, our productivity is 7.9. If you had run a batch process, then the actual residence time would have been not 5 hours, more like 18 hours, 20 hours, sometimes even more. Okay. So, you are getting much lower productivity in the batch equipments that you see operating in this country. Continuous fermentations are not very common around the world, not very common. Okay. There are only few factories. If I ask you why is it that continuous fermentations are not very common, people prefer a batch, what would be our answer? Why is it that people prefer to do alcoholic fermentation in a batch? Why would they prefer batch? In fact, you would see if you go to places like Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh and all that, there are much smaller distilleries, 5 kiloliters per day, 2 kiloliters per day, small plants are running, you see, and therefore, the productivities are much lower. Okay. And therefore, many of these alcohol, they are not going for pharmaceutical, not controlled by government, various issues are there, you know, in the commercial sector. But the problem is that this productivities are very low, and there are not good answers yet. Okay. So let us just review what has been happening in this fermentation technology alternatives for alcohol. A very nice book, it's a PhD thesis, 1971, Berkeley, it's in our library. It's only about 120, 130 pages. And they have just looked at batch, chemostats, immobilized cell reactor, vacuum fermentation, and some combinations also they have looked at to see whether we can get around this problem of very poor productivity of the reaction equipment. Okay. So, what they have done is that, see this batch reactor, correct? Now, if we have to overcome this problem, what can we do? See, this inhibition due to product, if you want to knock out this problem, what can we do? Productivity is low, but we want to somehow get rid of this alcohol. You have to remove the product. How do you remove a product? So, they said let us do vacuum. So, what happens if you do a fermentation under vacuum? So, you have an equipment which is operating at something like 30 millimeters, 30, 35 millimeters of mercury. Okay. What would happen to alcohol? It will go into the vapor phase. Okay. Alcohol will go into the vapor phase and water will also go into the vapor phase. Okay. Not just alcohol, water would also go into the vapor phase. So, what will be the net effect of that as far as product in the broth or in solution? Concentration will come down. Correct. In other words, as the fermentation proceeds, alcohol in the broth would go into the vapor phase, we continuously remove it because it is under vacuum. Therefore, the reaction keeps going forward. So, continuous fermentation essentially helps you to knock out this effect so that reaction is able to proceed in the forward direction and give you a much higher level of substrate conversion. This has been proven in the laboratory for 1980s, lot of research is there which shows it is a very interesting technology from the point of view of driving the sugar to its nearly complete conversion. But a huge problem came when you tried to commercialize this. So, what happened was this gas phase which contains alcohol and water, which is at a pressure of 30 millimeters of mercury, if it has to be taken to the next stage of the process, you have to compress it. So, you have to compress from 30 mm to atmospheric pressure. So, that generally it can be released into the atmosphere into a tank which contains alcohol. So, you have to compress from 30 mm to 1 atmosphere. Okay. That compression is a huge cost. Okay. You have spent money in creating vacuum. Okay. Vacuum also costs money, correct? There is an energy cost in vacuum. You need power to compress the products to atmospheric pressure. So, the energy cost of production became very large. Therefore, while the technology of it seemed very attractive, able to drive the reaction to completion, you see. And therefore, since you are able to drive the reaction to completion, you can use much higher concentration of S. Okay. See, your S need not be 100 grams per liter, it can be 500 grams per liter. It can be anything, there is no great problem. So you have an advantage of very highly concentrated alcohol. Okay. I mean, it's from 3% you go to something like 16-17%, because there is a lot of water vapor in the gas phase. So, you do not get very high concentration, 20% you will get. So, to that extent you can save on energy cost of distillation, but the net result was that the energy cost of vacuum operation, energy cost of compression was so large that the benefits of using a much higher S was not satisfactory. So, after maybe about 10-15 years of lot of research, it had to be given up. In fact, the last chapter of this thesis sort of says very, very surprisingly, it says that maybe 5000 years ago they understood this. That is what it says, that technology of last so many thousands of years, we have not been able to fundamentally bring about an improvement in alcohol fermentation technology. That is what it says. That is very interesting to observe, that we still do not seem to have an answer to alcoholic fermentation, not yet. Now, something more interesting also has happened. Let me just draw attention to that. See, if you, see, it says, you can read here, Saccharomyces is the organism that is used all over the world. Saccharomyces is a fungi. They work well under acidic pH. So, the pH of fermentation is about 4.2, 4.3, and the pH adjustment is done by alcohol. Okay. But in 1970s, they figured out that, you see, the fungi works very slowly, then we should change over to bacteria. This particular bacteria, Zymomonas, it occurs in naturally in certain ferment, particularly in some of the palm juice it occurs. So, they have isolated and all that, and then they have tried to commercialize a process using Zymomonas as the bacteria for fermentation. And there are several laboratory, or even pilot plants in which this has been tried out, and it is excellent. Performance is excellent. The reason is Zymomonas bacteria, the rate at which it is able to do the fermentation is much, much superior to fungi. Bacteria works faster than fungi. So, something went wrong. What went wrong? What went wrong was that bacteria works best at neutral pH. Okay. And when you want to do anything neutral pH, which means that you have sugar solution, all nutrients all ready, and it is neutral pH, then invasion by several competing organisms become very high. Therefore, if to be able to operate a bacterial fermentation for alcohol requires that molasses be sterilized. Well, if you do it with Saccharomyces at pH of 4.2, the competition from other organisms are very low. So, alcoholic fermentations do not go through sterilizations if you use fungi, but if you use bacteria, you have to sterilize. So, the energy cost of sterilization and cooling it to ambient temperatures and so on, prohibitive. So, while the technology worked very well, economics did not favor its adoption. So, this also failed. There is a lot of research in 1980s which says that, you know, this can be done, but it is also not very satisfactory. I went to a factory, I will not name a factory, in 1970s. They said, no, 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 we have got a great idea, we are going to do this. They said they will do cell recycle. Okay. What is the idea of cell recycle? Rx is mu times x, correct? Higher the cell concentration, higher is the reaction rate. So, they said, I have got a great answer to this problem. So, they invested on what is called as centrifuge in those days, and then and did this process, and it failed. The process did not work. So, they were wondering what the hell went wrong, you know, or must fundamentally wrong, mu Rx equal to mu x must be wrong then, correct? So, they put more cells into the system, but the process failed. How do you explain this? You understand what I am saying? You have a process in which you have recycled the cells. So, cell concentration is several times more than you normally operate, but the process does not quite give you the results that you expect. Now, you got 36, you got 38 now, I mean it is not anything very different. So, what seemed to have gone wrong is, interestingly, see, when you run a process, particularly say batch process, or generally about batch process about 20, 22 hours, 26 hours, as the products accumulate, the bacteria starts to sort of denature, the enzymes starts to die basically. So, you have lot of cells in the output, but many of them are not viable cells. So, when you do a centrifuge and recycle, you are recycling cells all right, but the viability of those cells that you recycle are very, very small. So, essentially because the viabilities are very small, it did not give you any great result. Or in other words, pure culture fermentation, see alcohol is a pure culture fermentation, when you recycle, you have to be sure that what you recycle is all viable. But in the environment of fermentation of 24, 26 hours, many of those cells die, it does not survive. And that is part of the reason why it is the recycle has not been very successful. But interestingly, recycles are very, very common in waste treatment. See, in pure culture, it is not very successful, but in waste treatment, if you do not recycle, your process will fail. You understand what I am saying? How do you explain that? why we recycle in a waste treatment plant, but we don't have great benefits in recycling in a pure culture fermentation. The answer is, in pure culture, the product accumulation seems to have a very, very bad effect on the organism. While in places like waste treatment, it is a polyculture where there is predator-prey interaction, and therefore predator ensures that the prey is always active because the predator wants to eat, correct? So this predator-prey relationship ensures that all organisms are active. So waste treatment recycles are critical to success of a process. But in pure culture, recycle is actually not very useful. See, recycle, see this, people have tried recycle in pure culture like alcoholic fermentation, it's not very successful. The reason it's not successful is because during the process of fermentation of 18-20 hours, viability of many of these organisms starts to go down. Therefore, when you try to separate this organism after the fermentation of 18-20 hours and recycle, the viable cells in that recycle stream is not very large, and therefore it doesn't benefit you. But in waste treatment, what happens is, it's a polyculture. There are hundreds of organisms working, and they all work to feed on the waste that is existing. So the predator-prey relationship ensures that its very highly active environment is established. That is why recycles are crucial for success of waste treatment, and recycles are not very useful in pure culture. In waste treatment, the predator-prey relationship ensures that all organisms are always active in the waste treatment environment. We'll have to spend some time on ecology, which we will do when we meet. We'll talk about ecology shortly in the next class. So we will explain that. But ecology is what is crucial to success of what we call as natural processes. All natural processes, you need ecology. Okay. All right. So this sort of completes this part. So we'll go to the most interesting part of which is natural selection. How recycle affects predator-prey relationship? Let me draw that once again. We had a bioreactor, okay? Then we had, we put this back, correct? Now, what happens here? In the bioreactor, there is a lot of growth, and this growth is because of what? There's a lot of nutrients available, lot of food available, and therefore it grows. Therefore, you are starting with X naught, which is very small. So there is a lot of cell growth here, X, which you are concentrating here. And this cell growth is because of the polyculture. So that means this environment, the multiplicity of organisms present, they have selected what is most useful to this environment. Correct? And that you have concentrated here. That means you have done concentration of the most useful organism for your process, which you are putting back. But in alcoholic fermentation, you started with a pure culture, and that pure culture in this environment, it as it is, there is no ecology. Therefore, it is getting affected because of the accumulation of the toxicity or the products, and that is why it starts to die. When you do this, it starts to die. Because so much of toxicity is there, it will die. This is clear to all of us. Polyculture is what nature is all about, and predator-prey is what ensures highly active population. This is a very beautiful example of natural selection. See, Darwin talked about natural selection, and we have read in biology that natural selection is what happens in the natural environment. This is an example where I illustrate to you how this natural selection actually happens. You can do these numbers to realize how beautifully it works. The example is here, there is a chemostat, okay, in which this organism is growing. It says it's got a specific growth rate, mu m is so much and all that. And then this chemostat is working, and when it is working, suddenly there is an infection that happens. So what is happening? That you have this chemostat. Okay, and then it's coming in and going out. S naught is 100, okay, and it is going out at 80. So organism 1, this is organism 1, X1. Is it correct? Organism 1 is growing, organism 2 is growing. Organism 2 is growing, no? At an instant when their steady state is established, organism 1 infects the process. That is what it says. Is the problem statement clear to all of you? Your chemostat is running, S naught equal to 100 and its 80 is coming out, therefore, X2 is growing. Okay. So, you are running a process in which X2 is growing, and when the X2 growth is at steady state, suddenly an infection occurs. Okay. Infection means what? Somewhere from where this X1 has come in, some delta value of X1 has come in. Our question is, what will happen to the process? Is this question clear to all of us? The growth rates of both the organisms, all those data is given here, mu m is given, k s, everything is given here. Is this clear? So, let us say, suppose we make a plot of mu is a growth rate versus, and let us say this is what, this is organism 2, is that right? Organism 2, it is growing. Now, it says organism 1, one is 0.5 s by 50 plus s, this is mu 1, correct? And this 0.3 s divided by 30 plus s, this is mu 2. Is that clear? 10, is it? This is 10, is it? Okay. Now, tell me, I mean, what is our understanding of chemostats? Our understanding of chemostat is that d equal to mu. That means, when steady state is established, d was equal to mu, or in other words, mu 2 was equal to d when steady state was established. Do we agree? Okay. What is mu 2? Do we know mu 2? 80 grams per liter is given. So, if you plot mu 2 versus s, let us say this is the curve, this is 80, correct? And then corresponding to that, what is the, we can find out, yes or no? Is this clear to all of us? Now, we say it is, there is an infection due to organism 1. We should plot this. I plotted that, I will show you in a minute. That curve looks something like this. This is organism 1. You will plot shortly. So, this is how organism 1 looks like. Now, what will happen? You please tell me, by looking at this curve, what will happen? Is the question clear to all of us? We have a steady state of organism 2. What is mu equal to? Can you please calculate and tell me? How much is it? 0.26. So, it is running at 0.26 per hour is the dilution rate at which it is working. And at that instant, organism 1 has come in. Now, what is the specific growth rate of organism 1 corresponding to 80? It is higher than 2, isn't it? It is somewhere here. Yes or no? Organism 1 will grow faster than 2. So, it is here. So, what will happen in the process? Substrate, it, organism 1 will compete for the same substrate. Both will start eating. What is our steady state? D must be equal to mu is our steady state, correct? D must be equal to mu is our steady state. So, what will happen to the process now? D will become, what is D? D is F by V. Does D change? Our valve settings do not change, correct? So, F by V has not changed. That means, D has not changed. If D has not changed, what will happen to the process? Organism 1, it will grow, correct? What happens to 2? Will reduce. Then what will eventually, what will happen? Process. Do 2 will get washed out. You can see here that S will keep coming down, and then this will be the steady state value of S, isn't it? In the steady state value of S, organism 2 will be knocked out, organism 1 would be growing, and the value of S will reduce from 80 to some lower value. See, I plotted it here. So, you can see here, it comes from 80 to about 54, some smaller value. Is that clear? Is the phenomena clear? What I am trying to bring out, see, natural selection happens every minute in the natural environment. We are talking about biodiversity and all that today, but the importance is right here. Okay. That simply by adjusting your dilution rate, you have selected a different organism. Okay. For example, it is important to realize, you know, if you go to any, you know, any river which is starting, as you can see, as the velocity of the river changes, the ecology changes, the whole ecology changes. because dilution rates are so different, and therefore the organism that can sustain will also keep on changing. And this is an illustration of that. Is that clear to all of you? Why is it that organism one, this is organism 2 is knocked out, and organism 1 starts to grow? You can see here. Yeah, it is finally in the same at steady state, there is only one organism, which is organism 2 is knocked out and organism 1 starts to grow. In the steady state, there is only one organism. We are having a chemostat in which our dilution rate is fixed. Okay. Now, organism this infection has taken place. Okay. That infection has taken place. Therefore, eventually what would happen? Eventually, we said D must be equal to mu, because that is the representation of steady state, and our this graph says there is only one point of intersection, correct. At that point of intersection, D can only be equal to mu 1, correct. At the point of intersection, D can only be equal to mu 1, and mu 2 has to get out. Organism 2 have no chance of surviving in that environment. What I am saying is that I am running my process at D equal to 0.266. Okay. Under that environment, when this infection occurs, organism 2 will have to get out. Is this clear? Is this clear to all of you? Can you now see how in the natural environment this happens at every minute? So, that is why you see the organism that is populating an environment really depends upon the shear rate of the environment. See, if you just look at yourself, diarrhea, for example. What is diarrhea? What is our system doing? It is increasing the dilution rate to knock out the organism. Diarrhea is an example where it is a phenomenon of increasing the dilution rate so that it knocks out that organism. It is a natural response to getting rid of the organism. This is what happens in the natural environment. Is this clear? Is the phenomena clear to all of you? So, you can repeat this. So, there is second part, this is the same exercise repeated, saying that if on this side, for example, what I am trying to put across is different organism. For example, in this exercise, what I have said is that organism 1 is growing at 30, okay, not 80, at 30, and suddenly this infection occurs. Here the selection is for the opposite organism. You know, you can see here when you are starting at 30, see here, you can see here that the organism what is selected is organism 2. 1 is knocked out. Okay. The important point here is to recognize that the environment determines, if the substrate concentration changes, a different organism is selected. See the way nature is organized. You see, it is this organization that we must understand properly to understand the importance of diversity. Natural environment is much bigger than what I am saying, is much bigger. So, this phenomena explains how things happen in the natural world. Now, the question that we want to answer is, how long does it take for this steady state to get established? Okay. We know that at steady state, one organism gets knocked out, okay, but how long does it take? Can we tell how long does it take? Can we write the differential equations to tell how long does it take? Let us write the differential equation. You can solve it at home. Okay, let us write the differential equation. So, I will write for organism 1. First one is organism 2, is not it? I will write for 2. Is it all right? Yes or no? Why have I knocked this out? There is no, the infection is momentary. Infection is not coming continuously, it is momentary. So, let me write for the, there are two ways an infection can occur. One, that you continuously put in the infection. Let me write, I will come back to you in a minute. I am taking y to be the same for both. Is this okay? Our material balance? Okay, this is our material balance. Okay, this is okay what we have written. Material balance is correct. This we have knocked out these terms. Now, in problem this in 2.1, what are the initial conditions? What is the initial condition for this problem? It is at steady state. That means steady state value is what? 80 grams per liter is the value of steady state. That means at this point when this happens, S naught is 80. What is X2? And is going out at 80. I am talking about question 2.1. 2.1 is coming in at 100, going out at 80. So, what is the cell mass? 100 minus of 80 is 20, yield coefficient is 0.5. So, 10 grams per liter is cell mass. Okay. Yes or no? Do we all agree? It is 10 grams per liter is cell mass. Now, at this instant of time, this is zero time, an infection occurs. What is the value of X1? Let us say some delta, some 0.001. grams. So much has entered, so that the density has become 0.001 grams per liter X1. So much of X1 has entered. Is this clear? It is a momentarily. Now, can we solve this problem now? Initial condition is fully specified. Is it clear what we are saying? Can you solve this differential equation? Because initial condition is fully specified. X2 is known. Sorry, this is there, not S. This is S. S is 80. S0 is always 100. Okay. Is it clear? S naught is 100, S is 80. At the time of infection, X1 became 001. Now, instead of 001, you can put 0.1, you can vary that number. When I say how long does it take, it depends upon the magnitude of the infection. If it is small, it will take a long time. If it is large, the steady state, the new steady state will be reached quickly. Is this clear? Can you solve this problem and find out how long it takes for the new steady state to be achieved? Yes or no? So, similarly for 2.2 also you can do the same thing. What is the initial condition for 2.2? Our question, initial condition for 2.2 is S naught is, this is 2.2, S naught is 100, S is 30, correct? And what is X1? X1 is 100 minus of 30, 70, it is 35 grams per liter. And X2 is, let us say, 0.001 gram per liter, this is the infection. Okay. So, this is t equal to 0 when the infection has just occurred. Okay. Similarly, this is t equal to 0 when the infection has just occurred. Okay. 0 plus. So, you can solve forward march. Is it okay? Can we solve? Can we finish this problem now? Is it okay? Yes or no? Okay. Now, the question I want to ask you is, this is the most important question. So, how do we use the above phenomena to manage infections in a process? After all, infections are something that happens to us, it happens to a process if it is a biological process. How do we manage these infections? What is it that you and I have learnt when having known these phenomena? We have learnt this phenomena now, showing that if you change the dilution rate, you can knock out that organism. Essentially, what we are saying is that if there is infection, you have to change the dilution rate in an appropriate direction to knock out that organism, correct? So, we have learned that now. Therefore, if you want to knock out an organism, you change your dilution rate, okay? So, that particular organism gets knocked out. In fact, industry, what they do a lot of washing. It is essentially doing this only, correct? It is increasing the dilution rate to knock out the organisms. So, if you are talking about pure culture, you know, fermentations, if you want to knock out an organism that is infected your process, you will have to change the dilution rate, and that all that substrate will have to go into your waste treatment plant. You see, this is the problem of biology, that you have to accept this huge amount of waste that has to go into a treatment plant. But that is something that we have to accept if there is an infection. Okay? All right, I will stop there.